Welcome to Power Shift, created to give diverse women a voice in how we lead, live, and find meaning. This series is in conjunction with Your Hour, Her Power, a Dress for Success campaign dedicated to getting women back to work, especially in response to the $800 billion in wages lost to women during the pandemic. The theme for this episode explores what we means in 2022 and beyond, and how we create community for ourselves, our companies, and our worlds. I'm honored to be alongside this group of highly accomplished women today. Looking at the past 2 years, it's hard to describe the shifts and the experiences we've lived through, but pandemic to start, I think we've seen more clearly disparities in access to healthcare, racial inequality, a return to domestic obligation for many women, a retreat from the workforce, lots of things. In 2022, what does we mean to you when we look at we, capital W?
One of the things that I think has been really interesting over the course of the last couple of years is that need to see all the different facets of yourself and to make sure you are putting them out there. And so it's connecting all these different areas of I'm a working mother, I'm a spouse, I'm a child of family who's gotten COVID, I'm a white woman at a time when we have racial unrest. What is my role in all of those different areas to be able to bring those silos together? And I think it's incredibly important that we lean in and that we understand that I'm nervous, right? I don't know what my role looks like, but I know that I have to be vulnerable and show people that we have different sides to us. And that's what makes us unique. And that's what differentiates our experiences. And that's good. But in doing that, you also have to make sure that you're going to fight the fight. Like, I will no longer stand in a room and have people, whether they're saying things about women or working mothers or having people comment about race and ethnicity. No. My role is to make sure that all of those places that I can show up, I show up, because that's the only way we're actually going to realize true change.
So your bridge building is perpetual, and as we all I think should be and are learning to be, I hope. I want to hear Melissa's take. How have you, in light of everything that's being discussed, balanced empathy and action, and how do you look at that next to traditional measurements of productivity? So said more simply, there's purpose and there's profit, and they're not always aligned. This is a tough one. If you have an answer, let me know if you know how to do this.
Now, I work in corporate finance at my company. So we've traditionally had some very good measures in many parts of our company to measure productivity. But like most companies, a couple of years ago, when we were asked to leave the office for a couple of weeks, that obviously turned into a much longer time period. Initially, I think I took my laptop home and my charging cord and realized after 30 days, this is not a short-term solution. So for me personally, and more senior leaders in my company, there were concerns about productivity. There were concerns, are people getting the job done? We had some very good measures already in place because of the area where I work, but some jobs are not defined by a metric on a chart. So I created individual touch points with my team members, because what was missing for me, and I think for them, is you can't walk by someone's office with a coffee and chat or catch up or check on prioritization, really just to make sure things are prioritized appropriately. What I found is while I thought I knew my team members really well, those discussions evolved away from just work topics to personal topics, topics about their family and how they're really being impacted by not being in the office. As strange as it sounds, people love the flexibility, but they miss that FaceTime. They miss feeling like they're being called upon by senior leaders or recognized, you know, in the ways that we used to have in the office. So while I think productivity, I think, is mostly the same as what we had pre-COVID, if you will, pre-pandemic, and we've got some good ways to measure, I do think the flexibility and the engagement that's been created in different ways, either through Teams or other technology that companies use, has really helped us to connect a bit tighter, I think, with our workforce, even more so than when we were in the office. And I think that flexibility is enjoyed by both employees. And I think that increases engagement. And I think we all know that higher engagement scores, or in reality or in a test score, I think delivers better results for not just for ourselves, but for our companies.
I love what Melissa just shared, because a lot of what they are initiating through conversation is this reality that we actually cannot empathize with the soul until we are curious. And because curiosity is actually the precursor to empathy. If you can't even frame the question of the desire to want to understand, why do they do it that way, not our way? Why do they sit over there, not over here? You actually will never build the capacity for empathy to be able to walk a mile in someone else's shoes. And in this new work reality of blurred boundaries, you know, blurred boundaries between work and home, home and learning, learning and play, play and home, etc. All of us right now are sharing our strategies and our ideas from our homes and our makeshift offices. And we see a glimpse into our personal realities. And as Laura just said, you know, it's not about going back. It's about embracing those blurred boundaries and really leading with curiosity, from my perspective, to build those bridges in an empathic way.
I'd love to hear from you, Lori, on this as well. The, you know, the balance, the integration of empathy, flexibility, and business productivity, or, you know, empirical performance.
And very quickly, we realized we had to have a totally different approach to keeping a culture intact that relied on being together. And so a couple of things that we did right out of the gate is I was fortunate enough to listen to a number of different speakers on racial injustice, inclusion, diversity. And one of the things that I loved was a definition of allyship that I heard that included the four H's. And the first is, are you helpful by nature? And the second is, do you believe in the human connection behind our world? The third is, are you honest? Honest means you're telling your authentic truth in a psychologically safe way. And then the fourth one is hope. At any given time, people in our organization, our clients, our candidates on assignment lost hope. And what I really encouraged everybody to do was, when you were feeling hopeless, to reach out to somebody and say, I need you to lift me up, not compete with me, because I'm struggling. My father's really sick, or I'm very scared for my children that are Black and we're a biracial couple and the world is crazy and upside down right now. Or I'm on this side of the political aisle, or I'm on this side of the political aisle, and I work in the same office with somebody who doesn't want to wear a mask or does want to wear a mask. And so I said, really, you all, we have to allow everybody to psychologically show up who they are and keep those four H's in mind. And if we do that, we can have respectful discourse and still allow people to be their authentic self. That was a game changer for our organization, because it kind of threw our KPIs out the window, and everybody just started producing because they felt like they could breathe. And so we're never going back to anything else. You can't get promoted or hired if you don't have the four H's.
Cheyenne, this past 2 years, it's been hard to describe the shifts we've seen, the consciousness, awareness that we hope are beginning to impact the way we behave. A lot of these issues have been visible to many people, especially people of color, forever. And it is something that some of us have had the privilege of not reckoning with until recently. How are you building bridges and contemplating your own work?
Well, I think you're right, Sam, that these effects have been visual for a very long time. And there have been a lot of communities that have been vocal about injustices that they have been facing, that, you know, have made it harder for them to access education and healthcare and the workforce, and especially when it comes to Indigenous and Black communities. And when it comes to building bridges, I think, you know, this is something that our communities have been doing for a very long time. And I think personally, you know, what I've done throughout this pandemic to encourage people, especially the marginalized and the vulnerable, Like right now I'm on the set of my show, Table Talk, and it was created for that purpose, which was to offer a safe place for the Black community to come and to dine together, to celebrate Black lives, to celebrate Black love and Black legacy, because that's something that we need to do right now. We need to feel connected and we need to feel encouraged, especially during these times.
And do you feel sometimes, really anyone, that you're relied upon to build bridges because of your identity? We've seen this at some of our brands, just as by way of example, that all of a sudden, Indigenous, Black, Hispanic, sexually diverse, gender diverse people are being asked, what do I do? And by other layers of a corporation, has that been an experience for anybody? Have you been called upon to hand out a strategy for free?
Yes, absolutely. And I think that's something that is that consistently happens. And I think, you know, I'll say that, you know, for myself, it's, you know, I'm tired of doing the work. Our people are tired of doing the work. We need the people who have established these social structures, these inequities, to do the dismantling, to come together, to sit and discuss and to strategize and leave us out of it. And I think that's the conversation that needs to happen right now.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. And I think that those are moments when you can find the empathy, is that the scores of engagement are productive for profit and for purpose, hopefully, because we're making a more united workforce that feels more confident. Shannon, how are you contemplating this fluidity, or I would think of it more as intersectionality, as you look at embracing all different perspectives and ensuring that they're heard?
It's a great question. And just to hop onto the last one, I guess I feel so strongly that purpose and profit go together. Like there, honestly, there should be nothing that you can't measure. Like what we're finding is the humanity, the purpose of organizations and what they have actually drives higher engagement, utilization, profits. So those organizations that are digging in, that are focusing on those elements of ESG, that are focusing on the systemic issues that Cheyenne was talking about before, how can we, knowing where our company is, help that community in education? How can we look at taxes differently? How can we look at bail issues differently? How can we look at public safety differently? Those are all things that before companies would not want to weigh in, right? Our people have a purpose to want to do more. You know, we talk in terms of allyship a lot and really talk about people have different ways of being able to really show and to be able to give their power and their privilege. And especially if you're white, that word privilege has freaked people out. And it's about sitting down and realizing what are the things you are able to do that others aren't. And everyone has a certain layer of privilege. It's understanding that, identifying it, and letting somebody have it. And I think that then broadens your definition of diversity. Now, let me be very clear. Being married to a Black man and having an interracial son, we have to do a lot of work on our Black communities and Indigenous communities and our Hispanic communities because we've never done the work. So we got to dig in and not decide, well, let's focus on every other element of diversity for the sake of that one being so hard. Let's move it to the back. So I think we have to make sure that we're not losing sight of where we've made our gravest errors in history. That being said, one of the things in working at home is we realize, and I don't know if you saw, like my dog just walked in. Like the humanity and realizing the diversity of people, suddenly you see the pictures behind them, you see their, you know, different traits that they have, and you realize that this isn't just this person that I thought looked like this and was that and was this dimension. Suddenly they have religion that's involved. They have different sexual orientation. They have mental health. They have all these things, and now we know that. And so I think your notion of intersectionality is really how we're building on this. Tell me about your full self. One of the things that we do a lot of is tell me your story. Don't let me tell it, right? My story is not the first thing if I'm telling my story is I'm a white woman. That might not be my first story. So don't allow someone to do it. You say first how you want to be identified and then how all of your different traits intersect in a way that you want to be represented as that individual and then begin to own it.
A theme that we're integrating into this campaign is everyone has a skill. And to Shannon's point around allowing people, inviting people, being curious about their stories, allowing us to tell our own stories, what skills have you seen emerge in yourselves, in colleagues, in friends that have really propelled you and your community forward?
One of the things that I've identified about myself is that I'm now more in a position to humble myself and to say to friends, loved ones, and community that to say, okay, I'm in a place right now where I need something. Let me stop. Let me take a minute. I'm feeling overwhelmed. I'm feeling triggered. The children are running around. The dog's barking. There's too much things going on my plate right now. I need to stop. And I think for me, I'm finally getting to that place where I can say, this is where I need to take a break. This is where I need some help. This is where I need to invite some people in that can listen to me and that can guide me to a place where I feel grounded. And I'm seeing that a lot around me with my friends and my associates and colleagues, that people are realizing that we need each other and that other people need to come into our lives and need to get us to the place we need to be.
So I think the ability to be vulnerable, ask for help, recognize when help is what kind of help you need is certainly a refined skill. We'd all love to hear skills you've learned that you may own and skills that you recommend we all develop that may have become more visible over the past couple of years.
So I have about 1,200 people in the company that are part of my organization, but we also place a lot of people in organizations. And I think one thing that happened during this pandemic and with the racial unrest, with the political unrest, with the socioeconomic unrest, I mean, it's been something I've never seen in my lifetime. I had town halls all the time where it was ask me anything. And I'm a believer in mindful leadership. And I have meditated on this. But what people really wanted to know is just like when you're feeling vulnerable and scared and worried, you want someone to ignore the methodology of the message and just help you feel better. Some of the questions that came at me were out of fear and anxiety and stress. And so I toned down the questions and I answered every single question on every single town hall. And I think it made people feel, again, that they could authentically show up themselves, ask anything, and get an honest answer, even if I didn't have the answer. And so that was a skill that I had to really, really develop, because it's when it's coming with your name associated with it, it can feel very personal and you want to defend yourself. And it wasn't about me defending myself or the organization or the pandemic or what the government was doing about the pandemic. It was more about giving people answers and a sense of peace.
And Melissa, I imagine in your position, you were asked a lot of questions and asked for a lot of solutions. How did you hone your skills and your thinking to manage that?
Yeah, a lot of the things I heard really resonated with me and were quite familiar. So we're all in the same situation, the same boat, if you will. Lots of questions around, you know, when will we be allowed back into the office? When will I be able to participate in face-to-face learning activities or development activities? People were concerned about their careers and their development. And initially you do get a little defensive. I think that's human nature, where you're like, I mean, I have these same questions for myself. It's really difficult to try to answer those questions. So to try to reframe the questions similar, to talk about my vulnerabilities, how I'm feeling the same way. I don't have every answer to every question. I will tell you how I feel about it, what I think about it, but we aren't in control of everything. So I think sharing our own personal vulnerabilities as leaders, I think really showed a different side perhaps than what we had shared in the past, when it was, you know, business was business and personal was personal. And if there's one good thing that we could say has come from this pandemic, I think the two have merged together a little. And I view that as a positive.
That's interesting that that's a positive. And anyone else want to, I think it goes back to Cheyenne's point regarding allowing that vulnerability to emerge that is might be really uncomfortable. Anyone, other things you've learned, other tips to remaining effective as leaders amid these moments of leadership challenge and ambiguity.
People have helped each other to find ways to find some mental healing. And I think that's incredibly important. And I think we need to talk about that. I think we have to have those conversations. For me, somebody sent me, because they knew I wouldn't read a book or do an app, I have these beads. And whenever it gets crazy, I was told one bead, one breath, just keep breathing through it. And I think when I think about all the years that I've been in business and doing the things that I've been doing, I think I held my breath a lot. Like I just held my breath and you power through it. You're going to get it done. You're going to grind it out. And man, now I'm realizing that, no, there's a better way. There's a different way. And now that's personal coaching to say, you got to find it. You got to do the hard work to change how you are going to come and how you're going to show up. And I think that that's been a very positive thing, but one that makes you feel vulnerable. But I think that that's a part of now who we are. And that's important too, as women, to be able to show that.
I just want to connect the wonderful things that Shannon and Melissa and Laurie and Cheyenne have shared. The great African-American poet Gwendolyn Brooks has a wonderful poem called The Song of Winnie. And there's a line in that poem that says, you don't get all your questions answered in this world. And I've always loved that line because there was some kind of odd comfort to me about that. I think sometimes the very, let's call it the pre-pandemic models of leadership have been about certainty, have been about solutions orientation, know the answer. And the opportunity and the gift right now is a new model of leadership that is much more about, I was observing that in my invitations into companies to help them build cultures of innovation, we seem to be starting at the wrong place. We need to start really with creativity. The hallowed halls of corporate America will look at you like you have three heads if you lead with creativity. It's because they don't understand creativity. They think that creativity is something that only happens in the theater, in the artist studio, and dance world. And it's absolutely not. It's about toggling between wonder and rigor to solve problems. How much wonder, imagination, curiosity, awe, pausing should we bring into this situation? And how much rigor should we bring into this situation, which is about discipline and focus and time on task? So when we are at play, we must learn to collaborate. We must learn to ask new questions. We must learn to negotiate. We must learn to anticipate what's around the corner. We must get better at all the things that if you're playing a game of hide and seek or softball to trying to seal a deal in your business, all of those techniques come into play.
So thank you, Natalie, for reminding us of the importance of play. So if we move into a bit of a departure, but everything's relevant, the Great Resignation, lots of headlines about this, often joined with the Great Resignation, also being carrying a theme of women, in particular, retreating from the workforce. As employees, as bosses, as colleagues, as friends, how has this Great Resignation theme impacted your work?
I read an article, I think just yesterday, that they've re-termed the Great Resignation to the Great Upgrade. So people are not just looking for a different opportunity, a better opportunity, increase in pay, increase in benefits, increase in flexibility. I think the last couple of years have had people value things in their occupation differently. And it may not be pay on top. While that's definitely a driver, I think, for a lot of people leaving, as we all work through having those conversations with employees that may be joining or departing, what they're looking for is different than even a year ago and definitely 2 years ago. So trying to adjust to that as a leader and as a company, because those don't always align with the things that we thought would attract and retain talent. And these are changing daily. So I think adjusting quickly has become the most important part to be successful in getting that top talent.
I would love to interject too, because we're a global company that employment is at the very heart of what we do. And we like to call it the Great Reevaluation. So I agree with what Melissa is saying, and what we're looking at is people want flexibility. People are concerned about their well-being, whatever that means for them. And do they have a sense of purpose in their work, or does the company they're working for have a sense of purpose? So we're seeing a lot more candidates that won't go to a company where they feel like the values of that company aren't aligned, even if it's a widget factory. I'm seeing a lot of people not able to articulate what they want. And there are a number of people that can help people find what is it that's missing? What is it that they're looking for? You're seeing people leave accounting to become a truck driver so that they can be on the road and explore. You're seeing people take very divergent careers. But some people are just saying, I need a better title and I need more money because this is the time to do that. And they can't articulate why. When are you happiest? When are you your most authentic self? Is it when you're around a lot of people or when you're solving a crossword puzzle on Sunday morning listening to jazz? That's a very different thing that brings you happiness.
Whether we're calling it the great resignation, the great reset, the great reevaluation, the great resignation, in my view, is really a symptom of people needing, desiring to lead, to lean into what I call the invisible work. When I talk about invisible work, I'm referring to that if you look at the 80-20 rule, 80% of the way work gets done is really when we need to marinate on an idea, when we need to ask different questions, we need to observe. It's not trackable. It's not about the output of widgets. And so it's symptomatic of needing to identify new metrics of productivity. Because in this fourth industrial revolution, tasks are being taken over by, there are casualties in this fourth industrial revolution with robotics and AI, et cetera. So if we need the space and the time to marinate, daydream, observe, go back, noodle on something, have a conversation, all the stuff that doesn't happen when you're on the Zoom, that doesn't happen when you're at the whiteboard, but it's the really important, hefty work that is actually going to lead to the innovative output. The great resignation, like that great example that Laurie gave of people wanting to leave accounting and become a truck driver, that's all about having space and time to do that marination work. So what if we identified new metrics of productivity that figured out how to incentivize and reward for that 80% time of invisible work? That's super interesting to me.
Yeah, so I was one of those women who resigned. Back in November, I was working for the government in a role with human trafficking. And I realized that I wanted more. I was doing a lot of paperwork. And I realized that that's not what I was passionate about. And even though the pay was very good, I wasn't satisfied within my spirit, within my soul. I wasn't able to give the best of me. So I made the very hard decision, you know, as a divorced single mom of three children, to leave and to start working for myself. And so now that's what I do, is I am a peer support worker. I consult women, girls who are going through sexual exploitation, who are going through human trafficking. And I feel a sense of pride. And so for me, it's my mindset has changed from the great resignation to like the great revolution. So I just want to say, I want to encourage you to take a leap of faith and just go for it. Even if you can't see the staircase, just go for it and take that step. You'll be happy that you did.
Well, we are all better for you making that very hard decision. And I think it's a great point that we hadn't made that is about risk comfort. Go for it. You know, we need to be reminded that that's okay. And so thank you for sharing that. That's very inspiring to me. Shannon, what does Dress for Success mean to you?
For me, Dress for Success means the opportunity for a future that's equitable, the future that's successful, and the ability to support people in not only how they look and they feel, but the hope that they have and the connections and the network that will make them successful, whatever success looks like. And I think to give that is such a gift. And to be able to be a part of it is something that is very humbling and something that is makes you emotionally connected to. People are getting their lives changed in such a positive way, and Dress for Success is leading that change.
So Dress for Success for me means leveraging my success. And I've had a lot of mentors and others along the way, informal and formal, that have helped me both in my personal and professional life. But leveraging my success to help other women transform their lives, it's really personally and professionally very rewarding.
As a mother of two, I have to say that what Dress for Success means to me is not only the women that Dress for Success helps, but their families and their children. And I've had the privilege of attending some award ceremonies where you hear some of the children that have gone on to be doctors and professionals because they saw their mother pull themselves out of a situation and put on a suit and go to an interview and provide a better life for them and be really brave. And listening to these children admire their mothers, it's not just making a difference for the women that are being helped, it's helping that entire community and generations to come. And that, as a mother, really speaks to me.
Wonderful. And Natalie, thoughts? What does Dress for Success mean to you?
Dress for Success is about building a bridge towards equity. It means that we understand that fashion is not a superfluous woo-woo thing, but style is our armor. It helps us to show up from the inside out in ways that exude confidence and also our personality, but it's the bridge to equity.
For me, Dress for Success, from its earliest days, when it was founded to create, I think, a community for women and a recognition, as you said, of the disparities, it's recognizing the bare bones of privilege in some ways and what you can give back, that some people don't have the right, an outfit that makes them proud walking into an office. So for me, it's about, in some ways, recognizing my privilege and recognizing my duty, obligation, opportunity to provide something back.
When I connected to Dress for Success 9 years ago, I was going through a divorce. I had 3 children under the age of 10 that I was completely financially and physically responsible for. And I was going back to school to get my first college diploma. So I was stressed and my budget was stressed. And so when I was told that I had to go on a 6-week co-op as part of my school placement, I was like, where am I going to get some clothes to do this? Because there's no way I had any room in my budget to do so. So when I walked through those doors of Dress for Success, instantly a relationship formed. And with that relationship, a mentorship formed. So to me, Dress for Success is about opening doors, women opening doors for other women.
All right. Well, thank you so much for having us, Dress for Success. We are thrilled to participate in this campaign and this movement. I have, as mentioned, 5 women, each of whom could be doing an hour-long keynote and TED Talk in one. Thanks so much. It was wonderful to meet you.